This lecture is dedicated to the topic of materials requirement planning, a very important procedure to elaborate the materials requirement and a very important step in the production planning cycle. The materials requirement planning is connecting the upper part of the planning cycle, that which is linked to the master production schedule, with the lower part of the production planning cycle, that which is linked to the scheduling and operative management. The objective of the materials requirement planning phase is that of fulfilling demand by synchronizing materials flow with the production activities. Of the two approaches which are connected, which are used in the materials planning, materials requirement planning is following the so-called requirement-based approach, so the push approach. In this regard, materials are planned according to forecasted demand of items as well as to already available orders, and by using data so that the actual requirements are computed. Developed in 1964 by James Orlicky, the Mrp procedure therefore aims at computing which subassembly, components and raw materials are required in order to perform specific production and assembly activities, and when these materials should be made available and in which quantities. In this regard, as shown in this picture, a lot of data consisting in the master plan as well as information such as the bill of material or production lead times are elaborated, and all this information is pushed upstream in the production cycle, so that this information is actually pushing the operational activities. That's why the materials requirement planning is also called a push materials planning approach. The ultimate objective of the MRP procedure is therefore that of coordinating through a rendezvous approach the production dates of components with the production and assembly dates of finished products, in this way achieving a theoretically zero inventory situation. From an historical point of view, the MRP has been leveraging on the development of the first computerization wave in industry, what today we call the third industrial revolution, and historically it was developed more or less in the same time with the Toyota production system. Nevertheless, the two approaches are very different in terms of application suitability scenarios and in terms of overall planning approach. From the IT perspective, the MRP procedure requires a lot of information, both coming from the technical and from the management domain. The most important data are the bill of material, the inventory status, the lead time, and other information concerning, for instance, the demand and the order portfolio and future forecast. This is the data that is usually used in the traditional MRP procedure. In the subsequent years, some enhanced features have been added to the MRP procedure so as to become the MRP2 procedure. In this case, also functionalities connected to capacity requirement planning have been added. We are not dealing with an automated resolution of some capacity and feasibility, but rather with a computation of needed capacity so that the human planner can solve some capacity limitation violations. This is due for complex reasons, both related to technological aspects as to managerial aspects, that will be discussed in the further modules. The overall MRP procedure can be simplified and structured in three steps. The first step is the so-called sum step, in which the gross requirements of a given component are summed. These requirements may be coming from internal production as well from external demand, for instance, spare parts demand. All these requirements coming in the same period are summed, and there they are transformed into net requirements by using available inventories. Available inventories are defined as the physical inventory which is on hand, which has to be increased by the already ordered quantity, and have to be decreased by the reserved quantities for previous production as well as for safety stocks. This because safety stocks cannot be planned since they are there in order to damp some uncertainty both in demand and in the production process. The subsequent step is the split phase, in which the computed net requirements are arranged into more specific production orders by using the recommended lot sizing policy. In this phase, for instance, an economic order quantity or a lot for lot policy can be used in order to optimize setups and to optimize production. In the third step, which is the shift phase, the lot sized orders are shifted backward in times so as to take into account for manufacturing or delivery lead times, and therefore to know exactly what is the right time to order the materials. Through this iterative procedure, the whole bill of material is processed and the materials requirement for the whole components in the bill of materials are computed. For the sake of efficiency, of course, when a component is used in more than one level of the bill of material, a specific sequence has to be arranged. In the case of this example, component C is used by many levels of the bill of material, and therefore on the right we see the right sequence in which the C component is processed only after all the items requiring these components have been already processed. Of course, the material requirement planning is just producing a list for a proposal or production order and purchasing order, which is then to be processed by a human planner in the subsequent phase of order release, order planning and order scheduling, which is the operative management phase. The MRP procedure has been designed for manufacturing environments, and it follows a very analytical approach in this way. From a single finished product, we can compute the requirements of all its components. But in the subsequent year, this approach has been adapted also to a distribution requirement, so with the so-called DRP, distribution requirement planning. By using this approach, the demand for the same item coming from multiple stores can be aggregated and put back in time so as to elaborate which is the overall demand of an item at the main distribution center. Then we can connect the DRP with the MRP, and by using this approach the whole supply chain can be planned. In the next lecture, we will see an application example of this procedure.